Good evening, viewers, and welcome to Catch Play, your sports development program, bringing you stories of sports programs and clinics, stories of athletes' struggles, identifying individuals and groups, as well as organizations that contribute to sports development. I'm Gobineki, and thanks for your company. And Mai, it's good to have you on the show again.
Thank you, Godwin. It's always a pleasure to be on the show.
Well, before we take a look at our stories for tonight, let's see what we have coming up for you on the show.
Coming up on the show tonight, sports anti-doping discussion, how athletes can be put on payrolls and how much they get paid, Lake Bilong Live Girls Fun Day, and PNG Olympic Committee Olympic Value Education Program.
Yes, and there you have it. That was your lineup for tonight's show. Now, we want to discuss on the use of performance-enhancing drugs. Yes, we're talking about doping in sports, especially in professional sports. As a developing country that's taken a huge interest in sports activities, both nationally and internationally. Now, to give you an example, before we talk more on doping in educating our athletes, after a continuous use of doping by the Russian athletes through the Athletics Federation, the World Anti-Doping Agency banned the Russian athletes from international sporting events after excessive use of performance-enhancing drugs. Now, Mai, as we all know, PNG athletes or elite athletes, we are preparing for the Olympic Games, and this is something we need to educate our upcoming athletes as well as our elite athletes on.
Anti-doping agency is doing a really good job. Performance enhanced drugs, a lot of athletes are doing that and taking that a lot during high performance competitions, and these are things that the coaches and the management of the team have to be really careful and to let the athletes know of what's going to be coming during the big competitions. It's just a random peek of an athlete out there. You might never know you're taking something that is a performance enhanced drug. Yep. And when you're tested, you'll be ultimately disqualified for a competition.
I mean, this is something our athletes need to understand, because if you're going out for a big tournament or a big competition outside of the country, there's a World Doping Organization that's keeping a close watch on every athlete, depending wherever you are. And if you're going to leave the area, you need to notify your coach or your manager, whoever, that you'll be leaving for at least 24 hours notice before you can go out and do anything.
And, this anti-doping, they have a group of people that's around the sporting arenas. You might never know that they'll be walking up to you and... maybe before competition, you're sitting in the competition arena, or after competition, when you're walking in, they will just walk up to you and grab your hand and say, we're going to do a test. I mean, to the Sporting Federation and the new athletes who will be selected to the Olympic Games or will be going to the World Championships, there's nothing to be scared about. It's something that the federations need to talk to their athletes, up-and-coming up athletes, and all the elite athletes as well. They need to still know about anti-doping, because it's the biggest concern in the sporting fraternities around the world at the moment. So this is a big thing to talk about in any sports around the world, especially Papua New Guineans, as now we're becoming a very sporty nation. This is something that we need to really look in seriously.
I think it's something we need to be aware of, because, people around the globe, especially bigger countries like America, Rio de Janeiro, these athletes, they're experienced. Even though they know they're taking risks, like, it's up to them what happens. But as a developing country, Papua New Guineans, we need to step up and show our athletes what not to take and what to take. And it's just, it comes down to a level of consumption, whether it's soft drinks or things. I mean, some of these things, like even an aspirin or Panadol, may have substances that we can't take, or you can't even take that medication, because people, when they test you for doping, for instance, that's when they pick out, well, someone's been taking something to speed the enhance the performance.
At least 2 years for the testing to come positive. I've been gone through that before, in that stage of being a very competitive athlete. When someone sees you competing in a high performance competition and you've been, medaled all around in all the competitions, ultimately they will know that this person is taking performance enhanced drug. And, they'll do the test, they'll take it, and it will take 2 years. And after 2 years, the results will come back to you.
Well, let's talk about once if you're tested positive to these drugs, then you might be banned for at least 2 to 3 years, even 6 years, or you can automatically be taken off the competition for life, meaning that you can't come back and playing at international level anymore.
Yeah, like for example, let's say the world's fastest woman, Marion Jones, you know, everyone saw as, I myself saw her as a role model, but after hearing that all her medals were stripped away from her because of her taking just that particular performance enhanced drug, they think they will get away, but the test is fresh once they've done the test on you. Like I said, it takes 2 years, but then they will go over the test again on the urine that they've taken from the athlete, and then it comes back. And you know, whatever medals that you won, the gold medal, the records you hold, I'm sorry, but it's goodbye to all those things, because we nowadays want a real sportsman and women out there, you know, using your ability to go out there and compete and, you know, show that you can do it instead of using such things like the performance enhanced drugs and, you know, other drugs that we don't know about that have, you know, positive stuff like the caffeines in them.
Yep. Just to take our viewers back to Pacific Games now, I was watching the weightlifting competition during the games, and Dika Toa was called to the backstage after her performance. And so I asked one of the coach there, and they said she was taken backstage for testing. And the same thing happened to Ryan Pinney as well. He was taken off the pool and taken back to the back to do more testing on. So that's these are elite athletes that people watch out for. I mean, it's not just them, but this is an example of what we should be aware of when we are going to be attending international competitions.
Yeah, for example, our athletes are going to the Rio Olympics next year, and we have like new people who will be coming on board to represent the PNG for the first time. So this is something that they need to take it really seriously. Like before competition or before getting onto the plane, or even though they're sick, always seek your med, you know, team first of what to take and what not to take during your competition out there. Because it will come to a stage where they'll be like, your athlete is disqualified. She, you know, she's made it this far to the Olympics. But
I think the simple thing is that before you go out to the competition, it's always good to ask questions, and you can never go wrong once you know what's the right thing to do. So if you're going to go to Rio de Janeiro next year, you know, good luck to those who are going to the game to represent Papua New Guinea. Just find out from your coach what you need to take, you know.
Yeah. And also, you know, visit the PNG Olympic Committee. They have the anti-doping team that's comprised of our very own Papua New Guineans who've been part of the doping team. So, you know, they would really much love to come and talk to you people and the PNG and the sporting federations. And you as an athlete, so you know a fair idea of what type of things to take and not to.
We've got the PNG Athletes Commission to find out more information about doping, and I'm sure they'll be happy to help you out. We'll go for a short break, so stay watching. Welcome back, you're watching Catch Play. Now, the PNG Olympics Committee works along with the Motuan Coastline villages running their Olympics value education program. So let's take a look.
The Papua New Guinea Olympic Committee Olympic Values Education Program aims to promote the role of sport in the society and the Olympic values of respect, friendship and excellence. Through its athletes commission, the launching of the Olympic Values Education Program in late September and early October 2015, with a series of school and community visits. The program uses athletes to deliver practical activities to school students and conduct community awareness to promote the Olympic values.
The program focuses on the Olympic values, which are friendship, excellence and respect. And the idea behind the program is to get Team PNG athletes, the athletes that have represented the country at the recent Pacific Games and various other games, going into the schools and telling the children the importance of those three values. Excellence, about trying your best. You don't necessarily have to win, But if, when you try your best and when you really put your effort behind something, that's excellence. Respect is about respecting yourself, respecting those around you, respecting opponents, respecting the rules, respecting the environment, all the various aspects of life that are important to have respect for. And of course, friendship. Having friendship and having friends is something that's very important and adds to the value of life. And so with those three values, we feel that the athletes can impart some of their experiences as well with sport and the power of sport onto the kids.
As part of the program, athletes will visit NCD schools to conduct educational presentation, interactive sessions and cleanup activities to the use of education station, a purpose-built portable educational unit in the form of a modified 20-foot shipping container. The container has multi-uses, has a museum-style display, event-based portable classroom, outdoor movie screen, unit mobile billboard, and display workshop facilities.
Yes, and that was the PNG Olympics Committee Education Program. And Ma, you were there to cover the story. Tell our viewers about that.
Well, this Olympic program is all about Motor and Coastline schools, where our very own athletes that took part in the 2015 Pacific Games plus the athletes commissions came up with this idea to go out and visit the schools out there and to promote the sport and to develop the sport that's not been, you know, touch basing on the coastline area. So this was something that was done by the athletes commission, which is supported by the PNG Olympic Committee. And you know, they've been doing programs like the Go Green, the cleanup on the beach, yep, the coastline. So this is pretty much the program that has been put together and been supported by the Olympic Committee plus the PNG, the petrol mine.
This is just on the coastline. This is not including NCD.
Our NCD schools have been touch base on like the Go Green. Do the Go Green and the cleanup on the beach. And then they touch base on the coastline, which is they went out to Papa, Boira, and Lealea schools. Yeah. And then they also took with them, as we've seen, the 20-foot container, the shipping container. It has everything in there. So yeah, this container was taken to each schools, and it shows them the different development programs that the Olympic athletes have been doing, and now they're sharing it with the kids out there at schools.
So is it just happening in and around NCD, or is it happening in other parts of the country?
Well, it's actually happening just in NCD, the coastline areas.
Yeah.
And they're looking at touch base, basing outside of NCD as well.
Because I think it will be good not just having it within NCD, but actually reaching out and touching other provinces as well, because I'm sure there are lots of other kids out there who would want to join into this program, and then maybe, you know, regardless where they come from, they're also interested into sports and things like that.
Yeah, you know, the main motive behind this is it's all about friendship, respect, and excellency. You know, all this come into place when the kids out there at the schools come in with that. They make friends with different, you know, kids from different classes, and the respect that they show when they play among each other. And it shows that excellency of what they can share and how they can be, you know, best peer friends among their friends and the sports that they're taking part in. And, you know, maybe they come out to be the next sporting models of the, you know, the very own place that they come from.
Well, it's good to run these programs, and they should create other little programs around it, you know, sporting activities where kids from around NCD or coastline villages all come together. You know, this is sports bringing kids together, and then...
Well, basically, this program involves sports. They do sporting activities. What they do is when the athletes are with them, they take the athletes out and the athletes go through demo with the kids with rugby balls or cone drills or how to do the relay. So the athletes pretty much do that, and they take part in all this. There's sporting events in there, and also they watch movies of different sports and the awarenesses of that and the workshop. That 20-foot container has everything in there. It has a workshop, it has a billboard, it has a TV in there. So it is left to different coastline villages, and they have to take that ownership to look after. So the PNG Olympic Committee and the Athletes Commission goes back to check up every time of what they're doing and if the program is developing in there. in the very places that they've put in.
Okay. Anyway, we'll take a short break, so stay watching. Catch Play, if you've just joined us, your sports development program. Now, as we all know, today it's all about money when it comes to sports. Yes, we're talking especially internationally, where top quality players for whatever sports, from football to league, are being sponsored to play. Well, I just want to get this across to our viewers, to you watching at home and our athletes. How much is it that athletes are paid to travel overseas? Now, we're talking about both male and female athletes. Now, this includes national teams and individual elite athletes. Now, Amai, you've traveled a lot with your, you know, sporting career. Tell us about, you know, what you've experienced as an athlete, because we're talking about money here. People get paid to travel, depends on the sporting code itself.
Well, you know, coming from an high performance athlete, traveling those days were like, it's pretty tough to be paid as an athlete who is doing really well there. Yep. And it's all about performance. When it comes to your performance, the coaches, the federations, the Olympic committee, they're all watching. Your performance has to be recorded every time on and off the field. And you know, disciplines also. So when it comes to performance, if you do well, you get a scholarship, and that scholarship covers everything for you. And you know, living down south, $300 was a fortnight pay for me, you know, running and competing for my country. And in you know, that was tough times, and we see athletes going through that. And I know that most of them have not been improved yet. Yeah. And this is
the basic thing. You know, you're talking about performance. It doesn't necessarily depend on performance, because we're talking about females. I think to actually differentiate male and female sport, males these days tend to get paid more money than females, and that's something we all need to work on. That, you know, whether it's the federations, associations, they need to work on that, because for example, SB Hunters, you know, they're traveling all the time, once a month, twice a month. They're actually getting paid more money than I believe our females are.
Because they have a lot more, exclusive appearance out there. They're traveling overseas a lot, and their performance. You know, you have to be an athlete. Rugby league, you can say it's a team sport, but when it comes to on the field, it's your individual performance. So you have to show the selectors, the sponsors out there, that you're doing what it takes to do. And you know, from there, you're selling yourself as well. And this is where they come up with and say, look, this is your contract. We want you to be part of this rugby team. And for us Papua New Guineans, like individual athletes staying, and we don't have that kind of competition a lot overseas. It depends on funding that comes in from the Olympic Committee, and also how we, you know, get sponsors from individual corporate companies, because it's all about exposing ourselves out there to be the top athletes and to get that type of sponsor and being paid that kind of money. Like you said, Israel Eliab is one of them who's going to the London Broncos. Look, that's his performance. He performed out there during the Hunters game. They were playing down in Australia, and now he's someone. So it can be teamwork when it comes to individual on field. It's your own performance, and it, you know, he's worked hard for it. The sponsors have seen it. Good on him.
I'm not saying it's bad that you know, congratulations to him. He's got the offer to go and represent, you know, PNG, but play for somebody else overseas. What I'm trying to say is that in that country, you know, in Papua New Guinea, males and females, sometimes, I mean, I know we don't always travel, especially our female athletes. Like recently we sent our team to New Zealand to play for the Sevens team, and who knows how much they got paid. And that's something that's not being discussed every day. You know, we do not know how much people are getting paid, especially when it comes to sports, our athletes.
Yeah, I've been part of the rugby sevens teams that was called Regianas, and we played in Hong Kong. And we won the ball against Kazakhstan. We got 2,000 kina, and just imagine how many girls that took part, 2,000 kina among the girls that played. And it's pretty tough sport, and to get a 2,000 kina, it's just something that we would say, it's just a one day money. So you need to really look at what
this performance
is.
That's right, you know, 2,000 kina may not be that much, but at least it went for something else. But if that was, imagine if that was SP Hunters winning the game.
They'll be having a lot of backups coming through.
Yeah, there will be a lot of money coming in. They'd be getting more than $2,000. So we need to equalize this. We need to have the same interest, whether it's females winning the rugby league game or the men winning the rugby league game. They need to be seen as equal teams or individuals.
It all comes back to planning and scheduling of your competition and also the, you know, your athletes that you've identified. And you have to work closely with the PNG Olympic Committee to come up with, you know, what kind of, you know, amounts that you want your athletes to be playing, and also present it. The PNG Olympic Committee are not the only people. They have to present it to the government and say, look, this is what the country's athletes are doing. They need to be paid this kind of amount. And when they give that money, it goes back to the PNG Olympic Committee, and then the PNG Olympic Committee has to share it among the sporting federations. And the sporting federations have to decide from there. So it's just like a big chain of things that they have to do, but it has to improve because, you know, after the Pacific Games, you've seen 20,000 kina, gold medal, silver medal, 10,000, bronze to 5,000. It's just, you know, that money is going to be gone, and you need these athletes. They will come back with another performance, and you need to take this seriously and say, these are athletes who have put their life on the line. So we should be looking after them properly, put them on the payroll, like we said before.
Wouldn't that be nice, getting a fortnight pay and just going training every day?
Exactly, I'd love that too.
Anyway, we'll go for a break now, so don't go anywhere. Welcome back, you're watching Catch Play, your sports development program. Now, last Saturday, League Bilong Life conducted a Girls Fun Day with students from Port Moresby International School, a program that is part of League Bilong Life to encourage equal participation for women empowerment. Let's take a look.
Last Saturday, League Bilong Life conducted a Girls Fun Day with students from Port Moresby International School. This is the second event League Bilong Life has conducted at POMIS, having the first in July this year, which featured Australian Jeralu Henny Sue Hopper. The event served as build-up this week's White Ribbon Day, which falls on the same day as International Day of Elimination of Violence Against Women. The 25th of this month is part of the 20 Days of Activism in PNG. The school sessions form part of the League Bilong Life program that encourages equal participation and women's empowerment. The event ended with talks highlighted the importance of White Ribbon Day and what we as community can do and address the issue.
Yes, and that was our League Bilong Life program for girls empowerment. Mai.
Well, it was a girls fun day out on Saturday, which the Port Moresby International School took part, and that was arranged by the PNG NRL. Yeah. They went out there. That was the second time they took part. The first one was in July, where they're the Australian rugby league, female rugby league player that came up and was part of that program. And this one was part of the enhancement of violence against women. That's going to be tomorrow.
Yeah, the White Ribbon Day.
It's going to be on the 25th of October. And it's the White Ribbon Day to recognize women who have been in violence a lot.
So yeah, this against women.
This rugby league program was all about girls having fun and being part of, you know, men's sport. We've been talking about that a lot. So this is what PNG NRL has come up with, and taking out the young girls to be part of it.
I think it's good that they're running these programs, because that's another way of eliminating, like I said, eliminating violence through sports, because we Papua New Guineans are known for violence through sports, and that's something we need to work on and start eliminating violence, not just on the field, but you know, outside as well. That's something we need to work on as athletes.
That, the respect among each other, the female themselves, and
especially towards our female these days. You know, we just wanna play rugby league or play whatever football, go home and start creating all these issues around that we're not supposed to be doing. You know, we need to respect one another.
So that was the important thing that was raised by the PNG NRL, the coordinators that were out there talking to the females about respect, about the rights of, you know, playing any sports, not other than rugby league. Maybe there's other sports that the women are also taking, but they need to start off when they're young to take up the sport. So it kind of also helps the mind to be strong, so when they grow up, they know that they're not going to be overworked all the time.
It's giving them the self-confidence, the esteem levels, rising it, keeping them comfortable, taking them off their comfort zone.
So this is a great initiative for the PNG NRL.
Well, I mean, I think that we should have more sporting codes, should take advice and start practicing these kind of activities where there's you know, gender equality through sports, and engaging women to start encouraging them to take up sports and keeping them off violence, educating our men to you know, trying to show them the respect that you know, they should show towards their female counterparts.
Well, MCD has started theirs off on Saturday, so they have Bougainville, Goroka, and other centers that PNG NRL has touched based on. They'll be running their Girls Fun Day programs over there as well.
Anyway, that's about it. Before we go, boxing tournament, boxing national
championships.
Yeah, national championships is coming up this week, next week.
This weekend,
yes, from the 26th to the 29th. And if you are on KVN, do check out the tournament. Our MTV sports reporter Elijah Lavette will be there to catch all the action.
It's also the Olympic selection trials for those athletes who will be trying to make it to the Olympic Games. So, you know, go out there and support them. It's a great thing for them to come over to KVN. Show them the support, your very own Papua New Guineans. And, you know, who knows who will come out to represent the country in the Olympic Games.
Yeah, but before they go to the Olympic Games, there's going to be another invitational tournament that's going to be happening in Fiji and Vanuatu. So that's another thing they are also preparing for after the national champs. Yeah.
Well, that's good
to see. That's the update for what's happening. Before we go, apart from national tournaments for the boxing event that's happening in KVN, we've also got other sporting codes that are also preparing for their international events, as well as the Olympic qualifiers. So wherever you are training, all the best, good luck. We'll be right behind you to support you and follow you through. Otherwise, that brings us to the end of our show for tonight. Anyway, if you have any sports-related stories, development stories that need to be heard of athletes or sporting issues in your community, you can send us an email to sports@mtv.com.pg and forward your email to Catchplay, or you can send us a post on our Facebook page, or you can see us here at Boroko Garden City Level 2 and ask for either myself or my Koime, and we'd be more than happy to help you out. Now, thank you so much for your company. Until next time, I'm Godwin Eki.
And I'm Mike Koime.
Good night.
Good night.